Hey, everybody. Well, please let me know if you can't hear me or something like that. I have my chats on so I can hear it, or a lot of you know how to text me, so feel free to do that. I'm pretty sure they're on stop streams. Looks like, yeah. There we go. Loud and clear. Thank you very much. So, I was teaching a class in painting class in Mashpee at Needlepoint Obsession, the store that's there. And someone loved this, but which this is one of my designs. It's now been retired. But she said, I love it, but I'm a cat person. I said, well, okay. I'm a cat person. I like cats. I like dogs. This sort of looks like my little chihuahua. Not really, because he's a lot smoother than this. And definitely not quite as cute as this guy is. But so how I started out trying to figure out how to change it from a cat to, or from a dog to a cat, quite literally just took a piece of tracing paper and I blocked in where she was and where the tail was, and I started to think about is this bottom going to be the right size for what we want to do with a cat? Would the cat hang differently? Which, yeah, absolutely it would. But I think that it is still okay ending here, because then we don't have to totally reinvent the wheel, which we don't want to have to do, because it can be a real pain to have to mix all of these colors that are in the background. The only thing I didn't realize is that I don't know what color cat she wants. So I'm thinking that we're going to do it maybe like a buff color so that it's a neutral and still can be seen. So I was able to sketch this in. When I started to try to figure out where to go. And then I had a really hard time with, I was having a hard time with the face. Doing a profile is just never easy. So I pulled up images, Googled them, of cat, and don't put cat profiles, because all that does is get you people that use their cat picture as a profile picture on different social medias. So I put side view of cat face. I mean, seriously, that you have to do that. But what I did is I just by chance putting that in got me a how to draw a cat where you're just laying in a circle, and where when you look at how to draw a face, they give you, they tell you how to do it by just using your basic shapes, ovals, round, you know, circles, squares, triangles, all these different things to kind of block it in. And so the hard thing I think with this was that the eye didn't really want to be where I thought it should be. It just kept looking weird. And so finally, after a little sketching, this part was okay. I was all right with this. But then the back of the head looked weird. And I was just kind of doing some light pencil work, which I inadvertently recorded myself sketching this, so I can put it out there to show how I got the head the way I did. But then it popped up in my head of Aristocats. I don't know if many of you know what that movie is. It is a Walt Disney movie from the 70s. And the mother cat in it is white and she's kind of poofy. Now, it just sort of reminded me of how they drew that part of the cat's face. Duchess. Yeah, I watched it way too much. I wanted to be an animator when I was a kid, so it was kind of my thing to watch was any kind of cartoons. And so that is how I ended up with this back foof. And I was happy with that. So then I proceeded to trace over it with a thin Sharpie. And with that, it's not always easy to see through a canvas once it's painted, but you can do it. And so I'm going to show you some basic tricks for how to eradicate something and change it out. For me, because I don't know how she's going to stitch this, I have to make sure that these colors are pretty much the same. So if she uses an open stitch and it can be seen, then it's not going to be this glaring color difference to the other areas. When you paint on needlepoint canvas, anywhere that you have to touch up, say prior to, with some white, is going to look different than areas that were not primed with white prior. And so this area, I'm never going to be able to make it look exactly like what these look other areas look like, because we have some pretty good eradicating we have to do. And to do that, it's going to be a really bright white. And as we know, white canvas is not actually white. So here we go. This has been sprayed with the matte medium, clear acrylic spray. I'm trying to make sure my quality is staying good for you guys. And it's just a light spray just over the area that I'm going to be working on. Okay, if for some reason you'd stitched another area already and you decided to, you wanted to eradicate something, what you would do is you would tape off all of the other area with paper, you know, masking tape, and then a lot of paper, and then give it a quick spray. Why are you going to do this? Well, I don't know what kind of paint they use. And while I know that it does not, I just don't like to take a chance of having it come back up. I know that they probably do not prep their canvas the way I prep my canvas with the matte medium, and which is this, which is the Liquitex. And they definitely aren't putting acrylic spray on after they use pencil, because I see a lot of times what they end up using is that they use Sharpie. Well, depending on the painter, it all depends. So for those of you that aren't trying to match something and you're just trying to get rid of a little area, this is what I do. I give it a quick spray with the matte medium. And now I'm going to take and put a little bit the clear acrylic on matte medium. And what matte medium is it is the clear base that any of these paints, pigments are added to make craft paints. We do it the same way with house paints. It starts out as a clear base. Then they add different clays to it to make it so that it coats really well. And then they add the pigments to it. Okay. So since we are only going to be doing this area, that's all we, well, and our little bone down here, we're going to have to change that out for a fish. Yeah, a fish. I might have to think about that. Can't really get a mouse in the ocean, can you? I don't know. We'll have to talk about what people think the treat for the cat, MerCat, will be. So we're just going to dry brush. There's hardly any medium on, and we're just going to cover up, because I also think when we hold this on here, it goes up higher. And it goes over. So let's bring some matte medium in. Hold on. My daughter decides to message me. My apologies. Teaching. Boy, that's the worst type job ever. Okay, so we're just going to keep dry brushing this on. Got to bring it up a little bit for that other cat head. Now, somebody asked me, well, how can you see it if it's clear? It's not that easy, but you kind of figure it out as you're going. You can see where it's got a little shimmer to it while it's wet. I like to do the back and forth over the top of it because it doesn't, we're not trying to get, it's translucent. It's always going to be translucent. We're not trying to get a solid color of thickness over it. We're just trying to get enough of this on to stop this paint from being sucked down into this canvas. All right, put a little down here. And so I'm getting off all any little bit of extra. I'm going back over it with big broad strokes to pop out any filled in if I got it a little too thick in certain areas. Okay. It's amazing how much this holds up the paint onto the, keeps it from being sucked down into the coarseness of this. So I'm just going to rinse out my brush now. Pull that a little closer. All right. Okay. Now. Don't want to go crazy, but I definitely think we need to eradicate out all of the brown. We do not need to go down into the tail, so we're okay there. Now, this paint is the most fabulous paint. Now, you'd think any thick shouldn't say thick, heavy-bodied acrylic paint would be as good as another. You know, Winsor & Newton, etc. Something about this M. Graham and Co. It just doesn't let, especially blue, bleed back up through the white, which is typical, especially with blue. Something about it, that pigment just permeates up through. So we're going to put, and because it's heavy body, yes, it's thick like cream cheese. Okay. All right. And for right now, that one looks a little wild and crazy. We're going to do the exact same thing we just did. We're going to dry brush in. And I'm going to try to be careful because I don't, like I said, I don't want to have to do an overabundance of redoing this blue and the pattern for the background. Now, I dry brush things on because, remember when I was just going woo, 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 back and forth? It pull, for paint, it'll pull it back off. Everything you just put on, it'll smear it off. So if you work your way through, an area and don't go back over it constantly, you won't lift it. You'll leave more paint on the actual canvas. Okay. So what I was doing there was a little thinner in the middle, and I was grabbing a little of the excess that was on here and spreading it over. It's going to require two coats no matter what. So don't worry about it. Now, this is not a dark enough color where I feel that I really, really have to do that, because we're going to use a buff color. I think we would be okay. So this is a number 2 Hog's Bristle paintbrush. This company is, I like these, but they used to be at AC Moore, and AC Moore's gone now, went out of business. Or was absorbed by somebody else, I don't know. And they're out there, this Snap brand by Princeton, but they're definitely not the inexpensive brushes that I used to buy. You know, they were the cheap ones that I could get from AC Moore, because scrubbing on this canvas just kills your brushes. Kills. Okay. All right. So I have the Zero liner of the Master Touch series that is from Hobby Lobby. And I don't know, I tend to use this one to mix my paint with and to add matte medium, because something about, even though they're both zeros, the bristles on this one are longer, and it's almost like I can't load the paint up the same way, and there's more bristles in. This is the short ones, the Zero Round Master Touch Fine Art Studio. That's the same. So that one's the liner, but like the short-handled kind. They don't have a really specific name. Now, I'm going to load up my brush. Okay. And I'm going to get a big old glop on there. And now I'm going to start to come in and leave a lot, do these edges out of paint on there. Okay. I hope this doesn't mess up my... focus of the camera. Okay. And I'm just grabbing a dollop and tamping it on. So I decided that with the cat, I am going to put more of a fish tail on it, mermaid tail versus a kind of like little hairy one that I put on the dog. So that will, I'm just going to go ahead and fill that one in. All right. And you just work your way around to have really, really good coverage. So what happens is if this has a color to it that, you know, it's like, well, why don't I just paint over the top and just not eradicate any of the color? Because whatever color you put on top is going to shift that color. So it would make, if your brown or if your blue that you wanted to put over the top of this brown had any kind of transparency to it, that brown would then alter the color of your blue, making it darker, shifting it warm if it was a warm brown underneath. And so trying to get it back to white or a pale blue by layering it that way can also work. But for what we're doing, and if you want really bright color over the top of it, always do white. Because backing it with the white is going to make the color really pop, especially if your pigment is a yellow, a primary color, a yellow, red, or blue. You'll find that with craft paints, and actually any paint, even from the tube, that it being a prime color means it's quite literally pure pigment. So they're just pouring that pigment in. They're not adding any white or base color to shift it a little lighter. You want red, red. You want your, you know, ultramarine blue, bright and vibrant. You don't want it to have a slight dulled hue because it had that in it. Now, we are doing thin layers. It's very easy to grab a huge thick amount and glop it on there and really try to get it done in one coating. But what happens, I'm going to get this paint is now drying on my brush kind of high up and it's creating a weird little collar. So I'm wiping off the majority of it, giving it a quick rinse. I'm not going to waste that paint. I'm going to let it be on the little dog. On the area we're redefining. Okay. And let's see if putting it down here makes it easier for you to see me grabbing paint. Okay. Totally forgot where I was. Oh, so then you have this heavily painted, thick-bodied paint on this canvas that now looks really like you're never going to pull that needle through. There's so much paint on there. Those holes are so close to filled that forget about it. Get the pliers out to help pull that needle through. So keep it thin. Build it up, gradually. I know we just want it done fast, fast, fast. But in the end, the quality, because again, if you're doing an open stitch, what would happen if this paint was so thick that it just looked like they were all painted clothes? You've painted it so that there you can barely see any of the hole. That's no good. If it's not an issue because you're going to do basket weave or you're going to do a stitch that's going to cover everything, still do thin layers. Do it right. And even though it might take you a little bit of time, if you have to do a stitch over it, you will not be happy if it's very difficult to pull through. And again, I'm just pulling that paint off my brush I've gotten it a little too high. You'll notice that the majority of the time, my paint doesn't get much higher than that. Unless I am naughty and I use my bristles to mix my paint colors because I just want some quick, subtle shift in color. And so I grab a bunch of paint. It's like, oh, dear. Then you have to roll it and try to get it down out of your bristles. So the reason why your paintbrush starts to curl at the end is because synthetic paintbrushes don't break, their bristles don't break away and get shorter like natural ones do. They are plastic and so they curl. So I try to, turn the brush in my hand so that maybe I can get it to kind of curl back the other way, get a little more time out of each brush, but yeah, that theory doesn't really work that well. My favorite brush ever, which you may have already heard me say that, was a natural brush, Mongoose. It's the only one that had the firmness. Sable is just way too soft and cannot stand up to the scrubbing. That I think everybody does it that paints this stuff, because you gotta get those little bits down in the gutters in the weave to really get that paint down in there. If anybody has a question, please type it. I can see it, even though I'm a little hyper-focused at the moment. Okay. We are almost there. So we will be utilizing, I kept this paw, but I made it a little longer, and I kept that paw, but we still have to eradicate the color because we're going to do it a light neutral color because I'm brilliant and didn't ask her what color her cat was. Some reason I want to say it's a tuxedo, but I don't dare make it a tuxedo because no way do I want to have to go back over black and dark gray if she goes, yeah, no, you guessed wrong. Or you remembered what you wanted to remember because you like tuxedo cats. I like tuxedo cats because they're talky. They love to talk. Well, mine did. And I love orange cats. Who are we kidding? I love all cats. I had so many cats growing up on the farm that it looked like the circus was coming to town when I went out to the barn. They'd all follow me everywhere. Okay. Just a little left to go. Now, this paint does have a gloss finish to it. So you do have to watch when you're painting over it that you have to, oh, are you not going to, I clogged a hole and it's not going to pop out. Sometimes I cover it with matte medium so there's a little tooth there when I'm painting over it because it's very easy to have your paint not cover as well because it's gloss. I mean, that makes sense, right? All right. Almost there. Now, then what happened when this person asked me to do a cat, someone else said, oh my gosh, I have that canvas at home. Have you ever thought of putting a baby on it? And I said, oh my gosh. Well, number one, every baby looks different. Cats, dogs, they can be kind of modified. Not saying that they aren't all special little peoples. But, yeah, so I have a feeling somebody's, because she's a friend, she's going to be like, come on! You made it look so easy putting a cat on there. Okay. I think we have good enough coverage. So we shouldn't have any issues with that. Now, I will go ahead and get rid of this one until we figure out. That might be a tomorrow issue. I don't know. Might have to sleep on it, do a vote. What needs to be on the cat's plate? because they are supposed to be in the ocean, on the ocean floor. Okay, like that. Okay. Next part. So here's our cat. Okay. And I was saying earlier, if you just joined us, that what I did is I just laid the tracing paper over it and started tracing out her features generically where the dog was, and then went from there. So let's try to put this. It's hard to do it with that other camera when there's a little lag in, okay. In the feed. So I'm going to tape this down. All right. And so all I have down on my table is a piece of mat board for right now, so it's white and it reflects up through. Okay. And so I'm going to line up the tail. And I'm going to line up her face. Okay, so I can see that that's all moved. Now, I have to do a couple things. I have to tape down my mat board that I am using as a white background. I lost the board that I used to have under my painting stuff. Don't know where it is. Okay, so that won't shift. More tape. Now we're going to put that across the top of the needlepoint canvas to the table so we can use it like a hinge. So we can kind of lift up and put it back down when we can't see where we're going. Okay. Now, I can see that my tail shifted. The whole thing shifted. Nutsies. Okay. And there's that there. And then there's that. Stay. Okay. Now. More white is needed, okay? Because that tail, might as well white it out now. So I can see right down through this canvas. I'm gonna lift it a little so you can see. Might be able to see, it's not really doing it any justice. Probably because of the angle, but I think you can probably see where that is for now. I'm trying to see on my other one that I'm recording on whether it's doing it or not. Not fabulously. All right. There's only so much I can do with these, and I've tried to get it to stop blowing it out. So now you're going to see, you can see it there. I know you can see it there. So I'm just going to take this paint and kind of trace. I went a little outside when I hit that one. All right, put that there. And I'm gonna start filling it in. I kind of, if you're taking the painting class, you will see the for the monograms, I do the same thing. I have you paint the entire background and then come put the lettering underneath and come back in to do the outline of the letter and then white it out. I think that for people that are, you know, just starting out, it's a little easier. Let me see if I put a little shadow over that, if I can show it a little better. I don't know. I think it's easier to just let you paint in what you need to paint in. And then come back in and do the lettering, because it can be, when you're trying to get a lovely gradient or just doing some shading in, now see, that's where our dog tail was. I think it makes it easier for people if they don't have to feel like they have to avoid an area. They can just come back in, put a little white there, and call it good. Okay, so here's our cat ear. There. Whoop. That's a little much. I might have to rein that in a little. Lift it up. So what I'm going to do after this, because there's a lot of white that has gone beyond where my cat body is going to be, because the dog was supposed to be poofy, that might have to be cut out. I'll come back in with the pale color and follow this. So I'm not going to move this outline that's underneath here yet. Okay. I'm kind of laughing because right now as I'm looking through this canvas at the shape of this cat's head, the front of it sort of looks like my dog because he's a Chihuahua mix. And he's got that little nose and that kind of high forehead. I'm looking at it going, okay, this better get looking more like cat. It's very difficult when you work with limited stitch areas to make small animals stitch the way you want them to. If they aren't painted well, sometimes they can get a little funky looking. And that's where I think the important parts of your pictures should always be stitch painted. So you're watching it, where you're putting everything, and you're doing a very deliberate coverage of those areas. I'm not sure if I could, if I bring it up square, it's going to look too dog-like. All right. So we're going to just put in this little patty paw. Love those toe beans. We had a cat, Andre, that was pretty hilarious because he was gray with white, very long hair. But right in the middle of the pad, the big pad in his front paw, he had like a little gray dot in the middle of the pink patty paw. It was funny. It was like he was some kind of royalty or something. Oh, look, I have the family crest on my paw. Okay, What color? Maybe start with some almondine. A fish on the plate. Yeah. Or should it be a fish skeleton would probably be too difficult just because of the area that we have to work within. I think I'm going to lay this ivory and this almondine in for right now and see. It's almost the color of my sand since I don't know the color of her cat. I'll put a little extra tan in there as well for when we come back to shade it. Am I still in view here? Yeah. Boy, it just loves to blow out the color on these. There we go. I'll kind of shade it for you with my hand, but leave enough light so I can see it. Now, obviously, the way that I am painting this at this second, I'm not even looking at where the stitches I'm hitting. I am just putting the line in so I can get my color down. Can always come back in and decide after, but I don't really feel like this tail is a major have-to area for the stitch painting. I have a compulsion, I must say, about painting to the stitch. Once you start looking at it and doing it that way, it's kind of hard to go back. Okay, so that line came in, but this is the line. Now, some people will say, you should use a light box under that. Been there, done that. Eventually, you kind of learn to do the connect the dots and anticipate. I do not use, oof, I just kind of went outside, got caught up on rogue paint. You start to be able to connect the dots through it and see it. And you only have to lift it a little to catch that area that you didn't really see yet. I'm probably going to make that thinner, either by removing some painted stitches on this side so that we still have a nice curve, because this is 4. But this is 3 here. I don't know. Kind of looks a little thick right there to me. All right. So I think add a little
my goodness.
Milk chocolatey. And come on, gray. Definitely want to keep this subtle. Okay. So I'm grabbing a little bit of the brown with that gray. There's a little bit of a medium tone. All right. And I'm going to bring that in here to define the cat's chest. You know, it's like I want to keep it this neutral color, but then I can't get it too close to what the mermaid's hand color is either. Because then it just becomes way too difficult for the stitcher. But like I said, if I'm so far off, I can always just say, okay, give me a picture of the cat and I'll just go repaint over that. But at least the initial aspect will be done. I am going way under there because I can see my line underneath there. Okay, so here we have, doing pretty good. We're getting it in there. Just grab a little of the light and bring it in and start blending it up in. Now, right there is my fishtail line that I have already kind of laid in. Generic guideline. So if we had this, that brown that we were trying to, we would never get this kind of coverage that we got if that dog's color was still here. No way. So we're going to take some of that and some more of the gray. Remember how I said this is how I get paint way up to the top? So I roll it and I drag it. So that it pulls, oop, let me get closer here. So when I get too much on there, let's roll it and drag all of that color back off so I can use it. I don't want to waste it. Now I need to come in and put some of this here because now the head comes up behind. So we have to lay a little bit. Okay. A little shadow there because we want to define the back of her head. Okay. Can see that I kind of work in a lot of little circles. And that's not my favorite white to use for this, but it's on the plate. We're using it. Let's Try to lighten it up just a tiniest bit. So we can put a little highlight here. Right there. Maybe a little on the boom. Okay. Now, I know that the woman whose canvas this is an advanced stitcher. And so I'm pretty sure she is going to be utilizing, stitches that will emulate fur and really make it pop. So even, like I said, even though I'm not exactly sure on this, it's really hard when it's your own painting. You have to decide, okay, how am I going to stitch this? Do I need to go through all of that trouble of the shading when I'm going to basket weave over the top with a variegated fiber? Right? I mean, you don't have to come in and put a huge amount of effort into shading and stitch painting, overly stitch painting. All right. Nope, I gotta put that there. I think we gotta put that there too. Gotta lighten that because this is the chest hair there. I'm probably gonna take it
up another notch.
Thick white isn't cutting it for getting the good flow of the paint. Okay. Okay. So we're gonna go like that. Come in like that. All right, like that. You know, I could make this a little more of a rough coat, but again, I don't know. I don't want to go too crazy that it scares her off either, you know? Like, wow, you must really think I'm a master stitcher. I think everybody is. I'm impressed with everybody's work. Because you guys know, I don't stitch. Can if I wanted to, just not my thing for entertainment, not my medium for relaxing. I think mine is, how do I want to put it? I use needles for mine as well, and I do a lot of stabbing. because I love to needle felt. I think I need to just jump in and do that head. I'm a little terrified of it. Why am I a little afraid of it? Well, you see, I don't want to have to white it out again because I go, yeah, that just didn't work. All right, let's take some white and kind of pop this along here. I need to find that stitch has to go. It needs to be skin color, just saying. And then we're going to put in the shadow here of the cat's paw. And then that should be dark, I think. Yeah. Which then means we need to bring this lighter. You guys still see what I'm doing here? I hope. A little bit of lightness as we come down. Then it goes to a shadow. Yeah, that'll work for right now. Okay. All right. Cover up its butt while we work on its face. Now, that should be potentially pink, and then it's going to come down like so. And then there, yeah, you start getting in tiny spots. Okay, there, there. Oh my goodness, I even used the color of my dog for this. Oh, so funny. Sort of the color. He's much darker tan than I'm. Sort of. Oops, sorry, just hit the camera with my glasses. Alright, so my eye will go there. And I'm not cutting this too thin either, as far as creating a wash, because I'm really not shading right now. I am, but I'm using more of a blend to create that. Mm-hmm. I have a feeling that this I is going to definitely be a challenge. Now, let's grab some black. So, when you do eyes, it can be very challenging to just do one stitch because then it just looks like a little hash. And it doesn't always come out looking right. I'm gonna take and let's see, the curve of the mouth was here. To make it look a little more cat and not so dog. I actually think I can should get rid of that. Telling ya. The details are what get you. Okay. So if we put that there, and we do. I'm just gonna fill in a little more with my darker color so I can actually see what we're doing. And then we're gonna shade it to pop that out. That cheek, right? From the eye, right? Emulate that puffy little bit right there. I want to put that squareness on the end of that nose. Worst case, we just redo it. We just knock it out. What color should we make the nose? Okay, I'm going back to the eye for a second to think about this. If so, that lead is probably just going to be a shade, 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 like one stitch, two, three, four, and maybe down one. Have some white there. This. We have a directional. Because I want it to look down. So if we do that. Then we do that. don't know.
Don't know if it's gonna work. We might be whiting this out and then put that white in there. And then if we take this, and our cat eye, would go like this. Told you, challenges, making the eye bigger, shifted it down. So if we have a white that's behind, then we have to put that down here. Am I losing you guys? You're like, Kelly, you don't know what you're doing. No, I am winging it. Totally. And I may come back to it. I may switch out, go down to the tail. Because it's not making it look down. Oh, maybe if I did, if I do, oh, that's too dark. A little more gray. There, and then there, then there. I'm just going to sit and monkey around with eyeballs. So this is still dark, but looks angry. Ah, okay. Slim it back down. Oh, there's a thought. There's a thought. What about kind of smiley cat eyes? Oh, that might work. Now, there's an issue, and I see it. Do you see it? If somebody stitches that, what's going to happen is, and they stitch it like a basket weave, it's going to not stitch right. Okay. Put this. This is my highlight that goes back. This is my darker that goes here. Then we have I'm going to bring this like this. Stitches. I feel like that nose needs to come out. And then we put one more there. Like that. Maybe. Is it too much of a blunt nose? All it takes is one little switcheroo. And it makes me question. Because I have a little... have to make the cat nose implied, and where it's at on my line drawing is here.
Bluey gray. And it needs a little, it's a little warm. It's pretty close.
And so that, like that, it comes up like that. Now, this might not be quite perfect for the... Oh, that was not a pun I meant to do. But I think it's good enough to... block in some of these. I'm having a hard time defining. Always remember, when you mix a color, it always dries darker than it actually, what's on the plate. Okay. If you notice, I always come back through and pop the bubbles with the clogged holes with my paintbrush. I'm dropping below where you can see. Well, you're just gonna have to hold tight for a minute. There. Yeah, I don't know how much texture I should be adding to this. I don't want to go too crazy. This background. Grab some of that. Then I'm gonna grab a bunch of white. Not bad. Pretty close. Should probably lighten it a little bit more, okay? Because it looks like it might go a little too dry, a little too dark. Okay. Try to kind of blend it out so that area looks similar. Okay. Not too bad. And like I said, this is always going to look a little brighter on the repair spots. Because it's backed in white and there was nothing pre-treating the canvas when the other painter painted on it. Now, I will admit I am painting these other areas to distract myself from his nose and eye bulbs. Sometimes you just have to walk away, let it sit, come back to it. Do I dislike it so much that I need to eradicate it? Or shall I just that definitely helped on that one. Nope, that needed to be lighter yet. There. I think that'll do better. Then I'm gonna do. Need the dark. Clean that up a little. That looks right. Okay, I must get rid of the eye. Don't love it. I'm going to come in with a little lighter. Okay. Now, I like the idea of the smiley cat eye. Well, maybe that's it right there. All right, let's bring this. A little lightning. We don't want it to look like Chippendale with the little white cheeks and then it goes all darker color up above. Okay. Maybe we want some shading there, but oh, that's the other thing I did in the sketch that I didn't do here. Okay. So we have the dark of the nose here. When it's stitched, there's going to be a void right there. And oh dear. And we were having so much fun and doing so well. Okay. I think we're going to have to. I'm going to brighten this up so that I can, so the two values that I used, this tan and the darker green that's right there, they are almost the exact same color on the value scale, even though they're two different on the gray scale, bleh. So then it makes it kind of difficult to see. They're not real contrasty. So this is literally a step down. So we do need to put the nose in. And what I mean by that is it's a diagonal consecutive. 1, 2, 3. We need to put this in or else it's not going to look right. When it's stitched, it'll just look like this diagonal slope. Going to get rid of this for right now. Back to the basics. I think we will switch it up and go do like a little tidy up down and not tidy up. Let's do the tail. Let's get that painted in. Make this into a bit more of a wash and have more transparency so that I can kind of come in and have a little shadow coming in. Maybe if I do this when I come back to do the eye, just won't be as difficult. Oh, I like that. That's okay. And then I'm going to come in and I'm going to put this. Yeah, like here for the chin, right? Yeah. Okay. I know, I say one thing and do another. Pretty typical. So the paint is building up, but it's not building up so much that it's creating collars. That's why I try to put on thinner areas, thinner layers, so that as I am doing this, it doesn't build up little mountains over each cross section, which is your stitch, basically. Because, yeah, you don't want that at all. That is so interesting. Because I look at that eye and I look at the line that I've put there, and there's just no way to get that kind of detail in there. Okay, enough of that. Now, I think we should do the tail kind of in this greeny, browny, and we'll kind of bring the browns up in. Okay, so the other issue is as far as the paint building up. Because I'm using craft paint, it's very thin. But if you tried to do this with the heavy bodied paint, I know that there are a lot of people that, or the medium body, oh, that stuff just builds up like crazy, 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 crazy. And so you end up with it being way too thick. And the benefit of having the matte medium on there helps you to not have to, it starts to get sucked in there, and so you put on another layer, and then you put on another layer, and then it gets so thick that you, there's no way of putting a needle through it. So this is why we try to, I like using the craft paint, because it does, you're able to keep it a finer layer than if you were trying to use the heavy body. Because, and you just can't get that pull, you can't get a good bead of paint just kind of flowing off, so it's, when it dries down, it's still nice and thin. Whereas with that medium to heavy body, it is so hard to get, oof, I see a spot that I should have painted. Well, I still got the blue and stuff over there. It just gives you the ability to keep it nice and fine and build up your color and have a good solid opaque coverage on pieces. So when I first started, I used the medium body paints. I was young and fresh out of art school, and had the whole theory of you mix all your colors. You don't use pre-mixed. You never use you know, color straight out of the bottle. That one is pretty rare for me still, because they're usually a little, just a little too vibrant for me. And I got started doing this. I answered a freelance artist ad in the Boston Globe, and it was for a needlepoint store in downtown Boston, Mary Jo Cole. And, you know, I had no idea. I just was like, okay, I had no idea about this industry whatsoever. And so I got the paint that I thought I should use. Well, then I continued to work for her. I liked it because I could work at home with my kids, babies at the time. And what happened was, is a lot of the time, oh, you can't see. Why didn't you tell me you can't see that I'm working on the legs? So I'm just going to move all of this because I don't want to move my camera. It tends to misbehave. Okay, so this is what I'm working on. So I was just filling in with some color. So what happens is, would happen to me was my babies would... I'd get a color mixed, and I tried to work at night, but it doesn't always work. And so I'd get a color mixed, and someone would cry, or someone would want something. And I'd have to drop everything and go take care of what anybody needed. And then by the time I got back, it was dry. That color that I just mixed, so then I had to use a bunch of paint to remix over the top of it. Oh, it just got really, really old. So then I started using the craft paint because, I mean, it was too expensive to utilize that paint. And it didn't go on very well. You know, it was really hard to get lovely smooth. I mean, I use matte medium, but in the very beginning, I mean, I was just using water, and it's like you can't use water, makes everything dry faster. It's just no. It's all no-nos. And it makes it more difficult. You want to make your life easier. You don't want to make it more difficult. So, now that we have, let's push this up a little higher, okay, and trust me, I understand, I'm not getting fabulous coverage from my green because it's a little thin, so I'm going to come back in and lay a little color over that. Can I just say, I am, even though you're not really able to communicate with me live as much as, say, if it was Zoom, this made my day because it was, I woke up with a crook in my neck, and it has been not a fabulous day for me because of it. It's just been, eh. Okay, so I would like to thank all of you for coming and watching me try to paint this little guy up. So here's my, let's move it back down. Here's, hold on. Here's the original. Okay.
Hold on. I gotta get you back into.
So do we see the issue? Now, this doesn't need that defining that far back. If we kind of blend that in a little, that'll help with it to be not quite so out there and bright. I'm trying to mix up some background color. Because I'm going to make it, trying to capture that little that's right there, splitting the hair. Okay. And I can't take out that stitch because if I do, it will look like a 90 degree angle when it's stitched. So you can see it's a challenge. All right, so what height is her eye at? And then if we took, all right. Okay. I'm switching gears again. The wheels are turning in my head. And the eyes are going to end up having to be a little bigger maybe than what we want. But it's just how it has to be sometimes when you're in, when you're looking at that, you can see how it's so small that trying to do that in between is just not gonna happen. So what I think I'm gonna do is I'm going to bring this in with a gray. Because if we put, so if that is there, so it should come forward a little more. All right. I want to put her, the suggestion of the top of the eye. It's not really a lash. With your upper eyelid. Let's see if we can get a suggestion in. There. We did there. And there. brought in. Squeeze every last little bit out of that little pile of gray. Not that you saw me do that, but... And I brought it... That is not where the direction should be, is it? Where the white spot should be. The highlight of your eye. In your eye. So that goes behind. Should it be? So if it's not there, is it here? I need someone to flash their pretty eyes at me so that I can figure out where that highlight should go. Because I think I have it. It's just trying to decide. Because it shouldn't go... It's not right going there. So we can kind of grab that white and pull it off so we don't have a giant mountain of white sitting there. Now I gotta see where my stitch is. There's one. You see? And then... This is where having reference material is a fabulous thing. I think it's that one. Yep. That's the one. Jeez, Kelly, took you long enough. I've been yelling it at the screen for 10 minutes now. Okay. I just noticed something. This is a square, practically. What the heck? There, there, there. That's right. Okay, I finally solved one problem and I've given myself another. Now, let's come down here. Let's try laying in some scales. So let's go there, there. I'm gonna grab couple there, up there, like that. So it's really hard when you're trying to do lines and there's like, we have to fill that in because if they use a basket weave, it looks like an empty spot. Always a challenge. Oh my goodness. Really? You know what we're going to do? We're going to start at the top and make it work as we get to the bottom because that just doesn't look right. I'm shading. while I have some dark on here. Right? Why not? Okay. Now, this green needs to be a little darker. If for some reason you're trying to eradicate an area and it just doesn't want to do it, okay, I want you to put another layer of matte spray. You know, put your matte medium down, do your matte spray, and then go back and paint another layer of white. Sometimes those stubborn colors, what are you going to do? They just don't want to be covered up. So now we're going to go like this. Like that. Okay. Come over here. That come here. I'm going to make them connect even though I kind of don't want to. And they're not going to go directionally down the tail because when you start doing the fun stitches, kind of don't like certain ones. You've got to utilize the direction of the way the canvas is. And trying to do things at an angle, ugh, it can be really, really difficult. She could completely cover up everything that I'm painting here and make a very specific pattern, because I just didn't make that nice transition there where those meet. I kind of stuck it out in the middle of nowhere. So she could just come over the top of this with a set count, a set stitch, and won't ever see any of that shading, any of that little bit there. And I think that looks great. I'm so impressed with everybody that uses those. But then again, I'm really impressed by people that basket weave. As a finisher, I look at your stuff and I go, wow, look at the back of this. This is woven together so beautifully. There is no way this won't stand the test of time. Okay, so now we're going to get a little smaller. Just a little. And it's going to be much more subtle as we get down here to the bottom, because I just kind of made our lovely darker green into a shadow. Grab some of our brown, some of our black, just using what I got on the plate. Okay. I Hope you guys didn't think this was gonna be like a 2-minute job. Because when is anything I do 2 minutes? I'm gonna come up and put some of this brown up in, okay, as well. Does it mean she'll stitch it that color? Nope. Okay, but now I'm going to take some of this matte medium, glaze it out, grab a little of that. Okay, so it's got kind of this greeny hue. Add a little of this in. Let's see. I don't know. Do I want to texturize it? Because if I did, because that's her finger. I need to get that skin. I need it even thinner, so I can play with it and not feel like it's gonna be so dark. I love putting the matte medium on and having it still be wet, because what happens is you can kind of do nice blendy gradients. As you're coming down, we can try to get a little more texture in, maybe not. Kind of roughen up her coat a little bit, right? Sort of like the dog, but not really, right? I mean, we don't want it to look like we slapped a cat head on a dog body. But I do like having a little more, less smooth. She looks like she's got a little long hair to her. What do you think? Yeah. I'm not hating it. Put a little dip. There. Thin it out some more. I've been doing this so long that my matte medium's even starting to get a little stodgy. So I'll probably come up and I'd like to have it peek off, but I don't know that a rough tail is going to work for this. So maybe we just kind of texturize it visually and not go too nuts. I'm going to have to go back in and clean that up. It's a little rough. Rougher than I want it.
And again, it's because all my paint is drying. Because it's 8 o'clock already.
How'd that happen? Yeah, that looked a little too weirdo rough. Okay, I don't hate that. Oh, we're getting back up to the face again. Trying to decide. All right, so now our head is all light in color. So we need to pull a little bit. Of the darkness in.
Need some new matte medium. Okay.
Oh my giddy aunt, you can't see the head. Seriously. Here I am sitting here talking about the head. Ugh. Ridiculous, right? And this is my life.
So we put a little of that, so it's a little darker. And a little shade up there. So we have the shadow there. So I think the eye is okay. Listen to me. I oh so love this that I'm like, eh. I don't know about this. having textural issues tonight. I know that you guys didn't think you were in for this. Come watch me paint, she said. It'll be fun. Now you know. Okay. Now we gotta hack at this nose. We have to figure out.
Little pink in the ears.
You know, it's funny because we're our own worst critics when it comes to so many things in our lives. And it's such a challenge to just take a breath and go, it's good. You got it. So to mute down your pinks, you can use a little bit of the green. I use a little bit of the brown, right? Oh, do I dare? Do I dare? Maybe. Do we dare use it for the nose? Okay. I kind of love that. Just this tiny pink dot on the end of its nose. I don't know how it'll stitch, but boy, I think it's funny. A little darker, maybe a little muted too. You know, I don't think I'm gonna get it any better than that. And I think maybe if I put a little highlight where the lip is, instead of having that darker color that I originally had, it will pull. That make it look like I want it to. Hey now, what was that? That looks like pink, but it really wasn't. Or maybe it was because I grabbed some out of the pink and the white that I just grabbed out of.
Okay, I can hear you all screaming at me. Don't touch it! I am not putting in whisker bits. Somebody else wants to do that. If she wants to do it when she stitches it, great. Good on her. I'm all set. That can be one of the hardest things to do, is to just stop. Just stop. And don't make yourself so crazy. Too late. Crazy. I'm crazy. Always been crazy.
Okay. All right.
Now we need the flesh tone. Now, I feel like I was this person behind the old general store counter that just bing.
May I help you?
I found your colors behind my counter. I have a little wheelie cart with all of my colors on it. Okay. Now, let's deal with this hand. Okay. So I think I'm going to grab... And this hand.
Too dark. Okay, now, if she's got her hand like that, where did she originally have it? Okay, came up to there and like this. Okay, so we got that. I'm gonna use a little darker, maybe. And then we can kind of make a little highlight on the paw. And let's grab some white and lighten this way up. Oh, we're so close to done. Okay. Boy, never say that statement until you're cleaning your brushes out. Okay. Because I just looked at this and went, really? Ugh. All right, so grab some of that. We're going to grab some of this little... left over here. Woo! Okay. We're gonna, even though that's the chest, I'm gonna kind of bring this. Get an almond out here. And I'm going to grab some white. Put this highlight on her paw so she knows where to stitch against that skin because they're just a little too close. And let's knock that down a little. I think it's just a skosh too dark. For where it's at. I mean, it's on the back. Let's just pull it. Give a little more depth. What am I doing? I'm muting it down. Enough. I'm done. Now. Sorry, guys. But the fish comes tomorrow. Because I gotta figure out exactly how I want to do it. But I would like to thank you all for joining me on this harrowing journey of a dog to cat. This won't be my last live broadcast. I'll definitely be doing it much more. And if you would like, I will post this tomorrow so everyone can see it. Probably later in the evening so you can see exactly what happened to. Can we turn it and get it all on there? I don't know. I'm going to make you nauseous for a minute. And I'll show you what the fish look like once I get it done, figure out how I'm going to do it. So thanks again. If you want to become a Patreon member and follow me as I make my journey doing finishing across country, we're going to try to do some live in-store I don't want to say interviews, but just what it's like on the road going to everybody's store and seeing all these wonderful finishers and painters. And if you're close by, but you can't make the class, but you can come in and say hi, I hope you do. All right, see you tomorrow with the picture of this
in the end. Now I gotta figure out how to shut this live stream off. Thank you. Thank you everyone for coming. And I hope it wasn't too boring. Good night, everyone.